Welcome to our worship service here at Stony Creek Baptist Church. We're so glad you are able to join with us. Let's open with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for this glorious day that you've given us. We thank you for your grace and strength. And as we gather this morning, I just pray that people would be lifted up, they would be encouraged, that their deepest needs would be met. As we gather around your word and around your table, Father, folks would be empowered by your grace. Father, thank you for the gift of Jesus. And Father, thank you for what he's done for us, for our church. And Father, as we assemble, we just give him the glory and praise. For we ask these things in his precious name, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Matthew 5:13. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled by men. And that is from the NIV. From the Good News Translation, it translates it this way. You are like salt for the whole human race. I like that. For the whole human race. But if salt loses its saltiness, there is no way to make it salty again. It has become worthless, so it is thrown out and people trample on it. May God bless to our understanding this, the reading of his word. Some years ago, a man came into a small mom-and-pop grocery store and asked this question, "Do you sell salt?" To which Pop replied, "Ah, do we sell salt? Come look." He showed him a whole side wall, nothing but salt. He said, "Do we sell salt? Come with me." He took him into a back room, wall to wall, nothing but salt. "Oh, do we sell salt? Look at this." He took him down into the huge basement, and there, wall to wall, floor to ceiling, aisle after aisle, nothing but salt. He said, "Do we sell salt?" "No, we don't sell salt, but that salt salesman, can he sell salt?" Jesus uses this example of salt to encourage his disciples in his day, and to encourage us in our day, how common folks like you and I can make a real difference, a lasting difference in the world around us. By God's grace, you and I are called salt of the earth, and we are called to be difference makers in the special places that God has planted us. And I want to encourage you, to pass on the salt. Someone at the table says, "Pass the salt, please." We pass the salt. We pass the grace in our lives to one another. It's neat as we look into how people in Jesus' day, how his disciples would have understood what Jesus said by calling them the salt of the earth. We do that, and I think uniquely as we celebrate around this table, that ties in together beautifully with what this table represents. It is a beautiful picture of how we can be the salt of the earth and how we can apply his grace, not only to our lives, but to the lives of those around us. So how do we do that? Well, first off, by remembering that salt was very valuable and influential. In the ancient world, salt was so sought after, it was used by the Romans to pay soldiers, it was worshipped as deity by the Greeks, it was used to pay taxes and buy slaves in Greece, and it was prized for its medical purposes. By Jesus calling his disciples the salt of the earth, by calling us, you and I, the salt of the earth, he is calling our attention to who we are, that we are valuable and we are precious in his sight. And both the wording, as we get through this sermon and the use of how salt is used and how this table reminds us of that, we need to focus first on how valuable, how precious we are to Jesus. And this is how God showed his love among us, John wrote. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. And this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. This table reminds us, like salt reminds us, of the precious nature of who we are in Jesus Christ. And to that we simply say amen. And secondly, this morning, salt was used to bind agreements or covenants. Salt was used in covenants to reflect their binding nature. We read in the Word of God, "Whatever is set aside from the holy offerings the Israelites present to the Lord, I give to you and your sons and daughters as your regular share. It is an everlasting covenant of salt before the Lord for both you and your offsprings. Salt is used in the Bible as a symbol of oath, of allegiance, and faithfulness to complete that agreement. It's neat that in Arabic, the word for salt and treaty are the same word. This is the new covenant in my blood. Jeremiah 31:31, we are in that new covenant sealed by the very precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. We are his church, the body of Christ. It reminds us again of the everlasting covenant we have in Jesus. Again, as Paul says, thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. And thirdly, salt was used in worship. Salt was used in the sacrificial system, was added to all sacrifices. Again, the word of God reminds us, season all your grain offerings with salt. Do not leave the salt of the covenant of your God out of your grain offerings. Add salt to all your offerings. It reminded the worshiper of the covenant he or she had with God and who God was. It reminds us this morning of the importance, of the vital importance of worship. And what is better able? Think of it. What is better able to define worship, my friends, this morning, than this table? Than this table. The old Anglican William Temple, I think, has the best definition still that I've ever heard. He says, to worship is to quicken the conscience by the holiness of God. That's what this table does. To feed the mind on the truth of God, again, what the communion table does. To purge the imagination by the beauty of God, the beauty of what goes into this table. To open the heart to the love of God, to devote the will to the purpose of God. All this is gathered up in the emotion which cleanses us from selfishness, because it is the most selfless of all emotions, the emotion of adoration. This table, maybe like nothing else, draws us as believers into the atmosphere, into the mood, into the consciousness of the worship of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And salt was used to stimulate a person's appetite. Job said, is tasteless food eaten without salt? To the ancient mind, in ours today, salt stimulates appetites. We think about it. Are there ways that we can stimulate? Are ways that we can encourage those who need to trust in the Lord Jesus? Are there ways that we can stimulate that process, that appetite? Are there ways that we can encourage Christians, our brothers and sisters in Christ, to stimulate their appetite to grow in their most holy faith? Are there ways we can encourage that? How can we be that loving and encouraging force in the life of others? As we look at them, as we look at the world around us, how can we be that loving and encouraging force in the life of others? This table reminds us first to look in, and then automatically to look out. To look out. And the image of salt was used to remind us of being peacemakers. Of being peacemakers. Mark 9:50 says in the NIV, salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can you make it salty again? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with each other. Be at peace with each other. Peacemakers. To be a peacemaker, we need to look at the big picture and what is really important. Matthew 5:9 in the New Living Translation said, God blesses those who work for peace, for they will be called children of God. Romans 12:18 in the NIV says, if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Live at peace with everyone. This table that we celebrate this morning is the table of peace. First with peace with God, and then peace with one another. And the image of salt reminds us of the power of our words, the importance of communication, so vital, the power of speech to be a positive catalyst in the lives of others. Colossians 4:6 says, "Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone." How can we make our speech to be, as Paul says, seasoned with grace? This table encourages us to focus on some of the following things. God's grace, to remind us, when we think of this table and God's grace towards us, how can we not be gracious in our speech towards others? To constantly check our hearts for sinful attitudes and motivations. Ask God to heal old hurts, soothe anger, and humble pride. Refuse to use what we would call corrupt speech, any words that would wound or discourage or tear down. Commit rather to using good words, kind and gracious words that build up and encourage. And find something positive to begin and end every conversation. And when we do that, focus on the other person. Ask questions about them and their feelings. And exercise self-control. Sometimes the most gracious thing to do is to say nothing. And salt was used for healing, used for medicinal or medical purposes. This table reminds us in Jesus' life, his passion, and his death, that he is truly, my friends, the wounded healer. He offers us true and lasting hope for our todays and our tomorrows. This morning, we can lay our cares and concerns at the foot of the cross as we gather around this table and ask God for his gracious touch in our lives. Remember the old hymn, "Burdens are what? Lifted." Where? At Calvary. As Jesus wept over Jerusalem, he weeps for us today. He is, my friends, the wounded healer. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly, tightly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet did not sin. So let us approach the throne of grace, or God's throne of grace, with confidence. One translation, with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. My friends, he is there. And go to him. He cares. He loves you. And we can help others heal in the body of Christ. We can be instruments, not only the Lord, but we can be instruments of his grace in the life of others. Listen to Paul's words as he says, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles." Why? So that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves received from God. You and I, my friends, can be wounded healers. We can draw others to God's grace. And salt perseveres. It perseveres. It preserves. It has that lasting quality that's needed both to persevere and to preserve. The disciples would have understood that well, being fishermen. It kept things from spoiling, holding things together for their intended use. This table reminds us this morning that, as Paul says, we are new creations in Christ. to be his servants. We are saved to serve, to be his servants as we do this to a world around us that needs to see through our servanthood his love and his grace, and above all, through that, his forgiveness. We think about history. We think about the corporate history of the church. We think about different things like churches and individuals and people and different organizations and what has been done through the church over the centuries. Yes, the church is not perfect, and it has things that have scarred it. But the church is an awesome force by the grace of God. The kingdom of God is here and has been an awesome force in our world. Just think about some of these things. Education. Our universities were started as places, as seminaries to train ministers and have grown into what they are today. The whole pursuit of higher knowledge, of knowledge and of growth, and how it's affected our world, our society. And women and children's rights. I think of Robert Raikes, the guy that started Sunday school and getting these poor little children off the streets that were chimney sweeps and trying to teach them to read and write and to have decent lives. Healthcare and hospitals, orphanages, all these different social things that were there, that were established by churches to help, to bring his love and grace into the lives of hurting people. Social networks. Our social programs often have been traced back, obviously, to the Judeo-Christian heritage that we have, and that those things bore fruit in the social programs and caring for people and being there for them. Missions, not only spreading the good news of Jesus Christ, but practices like infanticide and slavery were wiped out, or at least brought to the surface as being things not nice, not necessary, by missionaries and mission societies and the impact they had on that culture. Workers' rights. People that were being abused in the workplace, Christians stood up for them and fought for their rights. The whole modern movement, the democratic movement, what we think of democracy in the Western world, established from the premises from the Judeo-Christian heritage. I think about places like the Revival in England, probably averted the revolution like they had in France. The impact, the godly impact upon a society. In civil rights, again, we go back to the civil rights and even in the present day, the impact the church has had on the rights of people. And tremendous scientific and healthcare discoveries by Christians. They are just multitudes. Development of our modern language. It was influenced highly by the construction and use of the King James Bible. It had a huge impact on the development of language. We think about our seniors this morning, elderly, the care and rights of our elderly in our society. All these things and so many, many more were being Christians, being that salt in society. And when we think of things going on in our world today and we think, you know, I wonder how far the rapture is. I wonder how far prophetically the return of Christ is. We think of the rapture and the catching away of the church, and obviously the Holy Spirit that indwells the body of believers, the church itself, will be taken out of the world. What we call the restrainer will be gone. And what a world that will be. What a different world it will be when the influence of the church is no longer here. It will not be a nice place. Again, as imperfect as the church is, it has a tremendous positive influence on living in a world that is just and right and is loving. You take that out, and it's a very, very different world. I close this morning, the sermon part of this, with a little cartoon that I saw, and it showed Peppermint Patty talking to Charlie Brown. She says, "Guess what, Chuck? First day of school, and I got sent to the principal's office. It's your fault, Chuck." He said, "My fault? How could it be my fault? Why do you say everything is my fault?" She said, "You are my friend, aren't you, Chuck? You should have been a better influence on me." Should have been a better influence on me. Well, this morning, my friends, please remember in John 15:15, Jesus calls us what? His friends. We are his friends. And let this table, as we participate in it now, as we reflect again on the analogy of salt and how it plays into the Lord's table, let us remember that we are his friends and we are to be the salt to a hurting world around us. So, as we pass the salt at the dinner table, let's pass his salt to one another. Let's be his feet and his hands, his eyes, his mouth. Let's reach out to a hurting world around us, and let's reach out to our brothers and sisters in Christ and be that salt, be that influence in each other's lives. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your grace and love. And Father, we thank you for the reminder of salt and how it plays into your table and how it influences us. And Father, as we gather around your table now, I pray you'd be with us in a special way, for we ask these mercies in your name, in your Son's name. Amen. Thank you. Hopefully you have your elements handy. If not, as we stop and just reflect, we have lots to reflect on this morning, those eight different points that have been brought out about salt and how they relate to what we're doing this morning, gathering around that table, lots of food for thought and how we can apply that to our lives. So as we take a moment now just to reflect on our lives before we partake in the Lord's table, just take time to do that. And I just pray, Lord, that you would bless our time now. You would encourage hearts and make this, like one of the things was salt that was used in worship, make this a special time of worship amongst your people. So let's just stop now in the Lord's presence. This is a time of worship, and as we continue on in worship, we think about this emblem, the bread. I have this little wafer or cracker here representing the bread, which represents the body of Christ. When you think about the Christ event, as my old prof used to call it, the whole life of Christ, the incarnation all the way to his resurrection and ascension, his reign, his rule, everything. The God-man, Jesus Christ, came into our world, for God so loved the world that what he sent his only begotten Son. His only begotten Son. He came into our world. Just imagine what a transition that was, becoming human because of his love for you and me. And that's what this bread represents. And it represents a man going to the cross, the sinless Son of God, going to the cross and dying in our place because of his love for you and me, and taking the sins of the whole world. Can you imagine that? Past, present, and future upon him and dying for us, so that whosoever comes to him and reaches out in faith, reaches out in repentance, that means changing from what they're trusting in, changing to looking at the Lord Jesus Christ and trusting in him for their salvation, so full and free, if they trust in him, whosoever can come and be born again by the precious blood of the Lamb. So we say thank you this morning. Thank you for Jesus giving his life, the God-man that went to the cross to die in our place, that we might have full forgiveness of sin and freedom from sin, to be those new creations in Jesus Christ. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for this emblem, this bread, these crackers, whatever we're using to represent the body of Christ, to represent the humanity of Christ and going to the cross and living that life to show us what God is really like, to be that full revelation from God. We just say thank you. So Father, this morning we pray for your blessing upon this bread, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us eat with thanksgiving. We have a cup, the cup, which represents the shed blood of Jesus Christ, which is the representation of a giving of a life. The shedding of a blood is means the giving of a life. In Jesus Christ, as we celebrate in this table this morning, gave his life for us. As we have said, he died in our place. The sinless Lamb of God, as John says, he died in our place so that your sins and my sins, past, present, and future, are paid for. It is complete. The work is complete. Nothing can be taken away or added to the finished work of Jesus Christ on our behalf. We have that security because of his enormous and endless grace. Father, we thank you for this cup this morning. I pray your blessing upon it as we think about the shedding of blood, the giving of your son's life on our behalf, so that our sins might be forgiven, and that all he suffered in that process, dying on our behalf. We just simply say thank you. Thank you for your endless and enormous love. For we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant." We think of salt, a covenant, the new agreement in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. Let us drink with thanksgiving. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim, you and I, the Lord's death until he comes. And my friends, he is coming. Amen. Father, again, we thank you for this time of worship. Father, again, for those that especially need your tender touch this day, be with them in a special way. And we thank you again for how the Bible uses salt to remind us of who we are in Christ Jesus and how we can impact the world around us as we draw an analogy from the way salt was used in Jesus' day, in the biblical times, in the Old Testament, New Testament. We thank you for those lessons. And Father, we thank you how that ties in beautifully with your table and how we can think about those things. As we think about salt, we can think about your table and how it is just an awesome place of transformation and worship. And Father, in the days ahead, as we pass a salt shaker, as we salt food, as we do different things in our daily lives with salt, help us to be drawn back to this message in this time and think about how we can be that transformational power, not only in this world in general, but in the lives of our brothers and sisters in Christ. Father, just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.